Welcome to season 4 of the Jada Edwards Podcast. As always, God is giving us his word to share personal stories and great conversations you are going to want to hear.
I remember a time in the summer where I had just gotten some really good news, some ministry stuff. I was about to start a new project and I was excited because you know how you're waiting on that thing and then you're trying to be godly in case the Lord don't do it. You're like, Lord, it's okay. I know you're sovereign. But then when he does it, you're like, yes, you came through. Thank you, Lord. So I had just gotten some really good news and I remember I was about to call a friend to tell her about this news and she called me. And I was like, oh my gosh, I was just about to call you. And she was like, hey. And I was like, oh, what just happened? And she had gotten some really terrible news and was really going through a period of loss in her life. And I remember the first several minutes of that conversation just feeling like, I don't know what to do right here. Because it took me a minute to come down off of what was on my mind. And I was like, there's not going to be a point in this conversation where I could tell her what I want to share with her. And I really need to be present. And I don't want to just be like, oh, I'll pray for you, you know, the emoji, praying hands. And I really wanted to hear what she was saying. And I as she was talking, I remember this moment of being like, okay, God, there is got to be a way for me to be fully in this moment with her, you know, even though you've given me this amazing blessing today, how do I fully engage with her? And it really started to stir my thoughts about how often we're in this tension. We're in so many spaces in the workplace, some of you who have already sent in questions, in the workplace, in our parenting, in our friendships, in the daily highs and lows of our life, where we're trying to figure out how to navigate that space, love well, love God well, still be fully us. Because the challenge is that the tension is different than opposition, which is what we talked about when we first launched our series. Opposition is two things set against each other, and one is good and one is not, right, when it comes to the spiritual life. So you have sin and then you have righteousness. Those are in opposition. You have the flesh and you have the spirit. Paul says, if you sit against the flesh, you're not going to do the things of the spirit. Those things are in opposition. But like our humanity and the standards of holiness that God has called us to, those are not in opposition. Those are things we both have to be present in. And so some of the things that we talked about as we launched this series, I'm just give a quick recap that really got us started. The first thing we talked about was in 2 Corinthians 4. Y'all remember that? We have this treasure in jars of clay. That the Christian tension there is we've got this divine eternal treasure, Paul says, the goodness of the gospel, and it's found in this fragile vessel. And that really kind of sets the stage for all the other things that come up in scripture. And you really see it. It shows up in the life of Christ, who had to be fully man and fully God. It shows up in the endurance that Paul expects us to have. We're persecuted, right? But not forsaken. Like he knows we're going to have these experiences, but also we endure. And so over and over again in scripture, we find ourselves really not in this easy place of picking one or the other. We're in the challenging place of having to be both, right? It's like for some of us, as you reach a season in life, some of us are mothers and we're having to take on a different role as daughters because our parents are getting older. Or you might be, you know, a caretaker of a parent and then now you're a caretaker of a grandchild. Like you can find yourself, excuse me, in places that feel like tension all of the time. And so I really wanted to take a few moments tonight to drive some of those things home, to get some conversation and talk about what that has looked like in our lives practically. So I'm gonna just throw it out there with Don and Tion and ask you big picture as you were in this series, because y'all were here for most of them. What were some of your big takeaways or what were your aha moments?
Man, I would have to say I knew that this series was gonna be like it for me when you said in the very beginning that my affliction is not a measurement of my faith and the lack of affliction doesn't mean that you are more blessed. Mm. And when you said that, it hit home for me because I definitely grew up Kojic. So you already know how that goes, mm-hmm. But we were basically taught that if something isn't happening and it's not going well, then you're being punished. So anytime there was any type of affliction, I'm like, what did I do? Mm. how is this coming back to me? So when you broke down, that's not what this is. This is, Paul explains us, this is supposed to happen. Mm-hmm. That's kind of when I had my aha moment. Mm-hmm. And it was very at the beginning, and that set the tone for me.
Yeah, I think that can be so life-changing if you realize that, you know, as Paul says, there's a privilege to the suffering, right? Mm-hmm. I don't know how we kind of get off track sometimes in our faith where we really forget that everyone that God chose and God favored and God honored suffered. Every single one.
Yes.
Every single one. I mean, starting with Moses, you go through the whole thing, starting with Abraham, Moses, Noah, every single one, including his own son. And so it becomes, you have to work really hard to go through scripture and come to a conclusion that suffering equals punishment. That suffering is not often simultaneous with favor. Because we taught about the lesson of Matthew chapter 4, which is right after Jesus is baptized. And the Lord is like, this is my son with whom I am well pleased. And then the next moment, the Spirit is leading him into a wilderness. And so you have to extract a majority of the life of Christ to think that suffering is something that you should be exempt from if you're walking in righteousness. Because the real conclusion is that the more you walk in righteousness, the more likely you're going to invite suffering into your life. It's the reason why this world should always carry a sense of discomfort for us. And then what happens is when you have that, you end up spending a lot of your Christian life trying to figure out why God is mad at you or how to get out of the thing. And he's like, you're missing the assignment I have in the thing because you think this is a punishment. And so when we can see that this is a privilege, that doesn't mean that there's not consequences for our choices, but man, when God just allows life to happen, God, where do I honor you in this? What do you want out of my life in this? Everything is not a lesson to be finished so you can live it for somebody else. Because we say it all the time. This is for somebody, it's for you.
Right.
It's for you. It's for your faith.
Right.
It's so that you know that God is good even when he strips away things.
Yes.
It's so you know that God is faithful even when he doesn't do it your way. It's so that you know God is still in control even when the diagnosis doesn't result in healed.
Yeah.
Like, God is still good. And it's not just about a lesson. It is about growing in the knowledge of who God is.
Yeah.
And who he is to us. And so I think that particular statement, I have had many conversations with people about trying to wrestle with the idea that a good God who's pleased with me, who's favoring me, can still allow me to suffer.
Right.
That is a life-changing thing. That's great. That's good. What about you, Dawn?
Well, so I think my point is somewhat related to that, because I think part of it, Jada, is I was challenged when you said, I shouldn't expect to be at home here any more than I would expect to be at home in the airport.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right?
Right.
But because there's been this whole idea, at least in my mind, of that whole kind of set apart and sit into, we kind of talked about that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I was in a place where I was like, I was getting way too comfortable.
Yeah.
So no, I wouldn't accept affliction as a good thing.
Right.
Right? No, because
that can't be the Lord.
No. It's supposed to be good. Just a good life.
Right.
Right? Right. Like, I'm looking in. And I think, I think for me, it was really this idea of saying, no. It should be normal.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. Like when we think about Christ and we think about some of the things that he did, whether it's in the wilderness. Like that was the part that just jacked me up when we were thinking about following his Gethsemane example. Mm-hmm. I was like, wait a minute. This dude was like on his way to the cross.
Right.
Asked his friends, can y'all just pray just a little bit?
Right.
And then they fell asleep.
Yes, more than once.
Right, multiple times.
Right.
And so I think when I started thinking about that, and I was like, man, he has this impending challenge.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, Lord, I didn't even begin to think, I'm not doing like Jesus in the wilderness. Mm-hmm. And God knows I wasn't doing like him in the Gethsemane, because you know my friends fall asleep on me once. They're not getting grace for the second and third time, right?
Like, you're not getting invited back. Right?
No, right. Like, and I think that was the thing that began to challenge me. It was like, no, mm-hmm. accept the fact that you're not at home.
Mm-hmm.
And that suffering should be normal.
Yeah.
And I'm like, as much as uncomfortable as it is, and I'm like, and that, I was like, wait, and nobody, when I was growing up in church, we won't even dwell on it, but similar backgrounds.
Y'all.
Similar backgrounds.
Okay, wait a minute. How many of y'all raised Koji? We need to dwell. Somebody said we need to dwell on that. A few of y'all raised, yeah. Well, not even just coaching. It's not a bash at that. But if you are from a denomination that taught a very rules-driven exactly. kind of approach,
yes.
and that's not limited to coaching, so this is not bad thing that God uses all of our background for his
yeah.
glory. But I just have to say this because this is what happens when you have your friends up. Y'all don't. She was legit. Like, she had to ride a bike in a skirt. They couldn't wear no shorts.
Wait, the church
skirt.
Hold on.
And the denim skirts are back, by the way. But
it was a skirt with a kick pleat. Because you need to be able to.
So you can move, so you can pedal. That's right, right. Pedal.
Right, you can.
And go straight to service.
Exactly.
You can go straight to service in that skirt.
Right.
We've already talked about them church skirts. Right. So if you were here, then you were here. If you're not, then ask your friend. But we get stuck on some stuff.
We do.
That you're just like, this is what makes a good life, right?
Yes.
If I do these things and
right.
don't say these
I'm
things and
blessed.
Don't go these places.
And highly favored.
Mm-hmm.
And still suffering. That's the part
which,
that they left
off. But here's the kicker, y'all. You are blessed and highly favored.
Yes.
But the way you define blessing and favor
mm-hmm.
is what will get you.
Yes.
Because if you can say I'm blessed and highly favored, but man, you better know what blessing is.
Yes.
Blessed are the peacemakers.
Yes. Whoa.
Blessed are those that give mercy, that shall obtain mercy.
Yes.
Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. You know what blessing is because nowhere in scripture is it equated to prosperity
mm-mm.
or ease
no.
or material abundance. And know what favor is. Favor is when the Lord says, yes, I will continue to use you.
Yes.
I'll continue to send you. I'm going to put you in difficult situations because I know you can represent me well. That is favor.
Yes.
That's what the, listen, if you have a favorite child, don't say it out loud. Just talk to the Lord about it. Favorite niece, favorite nephew, favorite godchild, favorite whatever. They are not the ones you keep hidden. The favorite child is the one you put out in every city. Mm. Oh, he can do it. Child can't even sing. He can do it. I know he can. It's somewhere in him, you know.
Yeah.
She can't play drums, but just let her try. Let her try. Like, when you have a favorite child, you put them in situations that sometimes make them uncomfortable.
Yes.
You know what? The favorite child will tell you, those that grew up as the favorite child, they wasn't always good.
No.
You got a lot of attention. You were expected to be the best. You were expected to always come through, be the responsible one. That's what favor is.
Yeah.
So when it comes to God favoring us, it's because he said, I'm expecting great things from you.
Yes.
I have a high standard for you. I'm putting you out there in situations that you might not be qualified for, but I know you can do it in my power.
Yes.
Favor is not comfort and ease and being hidden. Favor is being put out on platforms mm-hmm. that you really have no business being on,
yes.
but he gives you the ability to depend on him.
Yes.
So you can say, I'm blessed and highly favored, but you better know what blessing and favor really is.
Yes.
Otherwise, you're going to walk around mad at God.
Right.
And he's going to say, I already told you who I was. I don't
yes.
know who told you something different. So we are blessed and highly favored,
well,
but that's the change. It's
yes.
the definition of it.
And I think that also means we have to hold loosely the outcome. Like when we
yeah.
think about Stephen's life, that dude
yes.
was blessed and highly favored and died.
Right. And we right. waiting on God to raise him from the dead. He
exactly.
like, no, that's
like,
it.
No, he was, it was a wrap,
yeah.
right? And I think that's the piece, though. We hold on to the outcome. I'm blessed
right.
and highly favored, so it must look this way.
Yeah.
And I'm like, no, I have
right.
to hold loose the outcome and walk in obedience. And if that
yeah.
means what it means
yeah.
I still trust you and I'm
yeah.
grateful for the opportunity.
Yeah.
Listen, that's good. Listen, it'll mess you up, y'all. It really will. When I think about how that has altered just really what is true about the gospel. I mean, you can't, it is almost impossible to pursue righteousness and holiness the way God has asked us to when we're looking for these constant pats on the back and we need this constant affirmation. Like one time God said, this is my son with whom I'm well pleased. That's it. He didn't say when he had a hard day, like, don't forget I'm pleased with you.
Right.
On the cross, on the cross, Jesus felt so distant from God because of the sin he was bearing. He asked why he had forsaken him. The weight of the assignment can make it feel like God has left you, even though you know he's pleased with you. Like, the reality of it is, he says, you need to trust my word. I don't change. So I might not repeat myself over and over again, but I told you this is where to go. You know what I'm saying? That's like my husband. He's like, listen, I told you I love you. Valentine's 2018. Why? Why? Right. I don't know if y'all got husbands like that, or maybe y'all are the ones that say I love you like every 3 or 4 years. You know those people. They're like, I don't have to keep saying it. I don't have to keep saying it. You already know how I feel. I'm here. We in this forever. You don't get all of that. Everybody's not driven like, I'm going to affirm you every 2 minutes. No. But I feel like that is how God is with us sometimes. He said, here's the thing. Here's the assignment. I'm blessing it. He's going to show you providence and start to open doors along the way. But man, you're not going to get a cloud parting and an affirmation message every single time you do the right thing. Mm-mm. You don't get paid for A's. A's are expected. Okay? You don't get rewarded for what you're supposed to be doing. That's in heaven. Right. Here, you just get to see that what the favor of God looks like, and that it can take on different forms in our lives at different times. Yeah. And so I think that's just such a good point, knowing what favor and blessing is. Yeah. Okay, Tian, give me another one. What's another one you had with all the notes you take?
I'm a part of...
She takes amazing notes, y'all.
I do take a lot of notes, y'all. They're a little bit raggedy, too.
But I read your notes. When you post them on Instagram, I'll read them. I'm like, ooh, that was a good point. Can I say that? Yeah, I can. I screenshot them. And then I'm like, oh, that was a good takeaway. Yeah.
You know, one thing that you said throughout this series that stuck with me, it basically put me in my place, and it was like, you know, a part of the reason why my nerves be so shot, it's my fault. Because you said sometimes we create this expectation of what our life is supposed to look like, and then when God don't line up with what we expect, we get mad at him. Mm. And I was like, wait, that's true.
Right.
So, you know, throughout the whole series, there was a lot of self-reflection for me, and I left here like, Jada had her foot on our neck tonight. It was just like Holy Spirit had us in here hemmed up. Because a lot of the Christian tension that I feel sometimes is self-inflicted, mm-hmm. or it's avoidable, or I know the word, I should know better. But even in those moments, one time you said that sometimes the will is in the wilderness. Mm-hmm. And I was like, ooh, and I've been trying to run from it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, my prayers are contradicting what I really want, what I desire. And God mm-hmm. is just like, girl, would you please make up your mind?
Right.
So there was just so many different things that they caused me to self-evaluate. Mm-hmm. And like you said, it's always for you first before it's for other people. And I just walked away full every single time.
Yeah, that wilderness point, I think, was something that hit me, especially because a lot of times you'll see topics in scripture brought up multiple times, and they kind of have a nuance every single time. If you're thinking about the children of Israel, well, yes, the Lord led them in the wilderness, but it was a mess. Pharaoh was a mess. He was saving the people, delivering the people, but they were not obedient, so they stayed there longer than they should. And so sometimes you get stuck on that one idea of wilderness, and then you forget that Matthew 4, mm-hmm. the wilderness that Jesus was led into, he passed his test and he was out.
Yep.
He wasn't in there 40 years. He was in there 40 days, right? So if you study what numbers mean in scripture, yes, there is a correlation, but look at what obedience in the wilderness can look like.
Yes.
God is like, you might still go through it, but it don't have to be two generations. You know, you can go through this and go to your next assignment. Mm-hmm. And so I think we forget that. We kind of get stuck in trying to avoid something, and it could be. I really believe this. Many times we don't realize that God is answering our prayer because he's answering it in a place that we didn't expect it.
Yeah.
We want him to answer the prayer, but in the environment that we want. And so he says, but what if the answer is in the place you don't want to go?
Yes.
And we're so worried about avoiding the place, we don't ever see the fruition of the prayer.
Yes.
Because it's not going to always be in the safe place. If you're like, if you ever mess around and say, God, I want to be closer to you.
Uh-oh.
See, somebody in here already know. Don't do it. Don't do it. Lord, I want more intimacy. Or, you know, I just want to, I mean, I've had those moments, you know, where nothing but the Holy Spirit takes over. You're like, Lord, I need to know you more in this way. And he's like, okay, then.
You sure?
You sure? It's not going to be at the mall. Like, that's not where we're getting to know each other. And so then then life happens. Mm-hmm. And then you look back, you would have never picked that situation. But then when someone asks you, when did you feel closest to the Lord? You're going to talk about that valley that you didn't want.
Yes.
You're going to talk about that low place that you would have rather avoided. And the hope is that as our faith grows, as we grow from faith to faith, that we look back and say, I wouldn't have chosen that sickness, that illness, that disappointment, that betrayal, that valley. I would not have chosen it. But what I learned about God,
Mom.
I don't know how else I could have gotten it. And now that I look back, even though I might not have chosen that path, I would not trade what me and God did together for anything. And so if you are consumed with not experiencing that, you won't experience God. This is the bottom line, you know? And so I think that that's something that I think is a constant wrestle. It's a constant wrestle for us. Okay, Don, give me another one. That is really good, Tiana.
I had, don't let my humanity cause me to question his authority.
Ooh. Yeah.
And so.
Talk about it.
Listen, that from, again, love the way that I was raised, but honoring God as, you know, his authority was something that was normal. Mm-hmm. But when I really started to think, actually, let me be transparent for half a minute, and then I'm going to come back. So when I moved to Texas 17 years ago, I had, anybody play spades? Can I, spades? Come on, y'all.
Of course.
All right. Thank you. It's a safe place.
I mean, the more serious question is, who cannot play spades?
Right. I mean, but just.
Ooh. Okay. We need to add that to women's breakout next conference. Next conference, Anissa, breakout session. Right. We want to set you up for success in your family gathering. So we're going to have a breakout session.
Right.
Spades, nerds. What else? Need dominoes. Things that. For the culture.
For the culture.
Okay, so we need you. Because when people over the age of 17 come up in there talking about, I can learn. You take that up with your mother.
Right.
Your grandfather. Somebody failed you. So that's all right. We got you. We're going to have a fun breakout. Help people get them ready. Acclimate them.
Well, so part of what I'm going to do is give context. So in spades and other card games, you bid.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you guess at the number of books you think you're going to get. And so when you're certain and you're working with your partner, you say, I'm going to get this and a possible.
Yes, come on.
Right?
Y'all she's going somewhere.
Okay. So when I came here to Texas, I had one and a possible friend.
Not a possible friend.
One and a possible friend.
Listen, one and a possible. Not a good two,
right.
Just one and
depending
a possible.
Depending on how everything fall out, right?
Hey, yeah. Sometimes you don't know about
you
that.
You don't
possible.
Know. That's right.
And so, but with us and this idea of kind of doing life in community, I have been really deliberate about saying, let me build and do life, right? And so I look at my life now and I think about my friends, and this is kind of where I'm going. I work really hard to love my friends well.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
do.
I give thought. How mm-hmm. can I love my friends well? And sometimes, you know, I'm like, okay, let me think about how I love them this year. Mm-hmm. I want to love them better next year. Mm-hmm. Right?
She does, for real.
Right. And so here's the thing that's crazy, y'all. When you challenged me on this idea of don't let my humanity cause me to question his authority, I was like, okay, I'm going to respect your authority, but and this idea of God being both, you know, having fear of God and friend of God,
mm-hmm.
right? And I was like, but how am I loving him well?
Mm-hmm.
How can I love the people he created well and not love him well?
Yeah.
And so then I was like,
that's good.
I want to say you know, I'm a friend of God, but is he really?
Right. Yeah.
And that for me was the challenge, mm-hmm. right? Was really to say, I understand your authority. I embrace your authority.
Yeah.
But I am not embracing your friendship. I'm not spending time with you.
Mm-hmm.
I am not letting you in on the things of my heart. Like, I am mm-hmm. sad.
Yeah.
And I'm not just coming to you. When you talk to your friends, I was like, I don't need pretense. I'd just be like, no, I'm not fit. Today is a rough day.
Right.
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 And I think there is that, for me, the challenge was realizing that I can embrace your authority, but I do you a disservice when I don't embrace the fact that you're a friend
mm-hmm.
to me.
Yes.
And I choose not to love him well.
Yeah.
So
ooh, that's good.
Good gracious. That's good. That's a word right there. I'm still that spades illustration.
Yeah.
So
one in a pocket.
When I say it, y'all be like, ooh, that was good. Act like you never heard it. That's what you do. No, that fear of God and friend of God thing, oh my gosh, that is one of those things that we tend to lean really hard one way or the other. Because you may have grown up scared to death of God. Like, don't do this. I had an auntie, she'd be like, don't be in the club when Jesus come back. I'm like,
the
rapture ain't hitting. Did y'all have people like that? Any church girls in the house? I'm like, the rapture not coming to the club? Wait a minute. So, like, wait a minute now. I'm saved. I had a rough night, but if Jesus come, I'm not trying to miss it because I had a rough night. And then you were just scared. You were just scared to death. Like, oh my God, I'm just going to go to the grocery store and go home. And it probably was somewhere I should not have been, but you don't want to choose the right thing for a wrong reason. God, mm-hmm. Listen, y'all, the highest motivation for righteousness is love. That's the highest motivation. In the scripture, God only resorts to fear and punishment when love doesn't work. He said, I loved you. I am the Lord your God. He starts off the Ten Commandments with love. Yeah. Before he tells them what to do, he tells them who he is to them. I am the Lord your God. I delivered you out of Egypt. Remember this. I'm your father. Remember this. Now, have no other gods before. Now he goes into his commandments, everything. So when Jesus says, if you're my friend, if you keep my commandment, he ties it to greater love has no man than this, right? Because love is supposed to be the motivator. Your kids, your children, your grandchildren will retain, you know they have retained your values when they obey without fear of punishment.
Oh, that's good.
They obey because it's the right thing to do. They love you. Mm-hmm. You've shown them how to love God, and that's why they obey. Yep. Not because they looking to avoid a hit or avoid punishment. Yes, it's going to be discipline. There's going to be punishment, but that cannot be the primary motivation. You know why? Because as you get older, you're going to learn how to avoid punishment.
Yes.
You're just going to get smarter with your sin. You're going to learn how to avoid discipline. Not from God, but you'll learn how to avoid it from people on. So you better have a love motivation. And so when you have anything other than that, then the fear of God gets twisted. It's not an awe or a reverence. Right. It's a literal, I'm afraid, I'm going to get in trouble.
Right, right.
And everything happening in my life that's not good is God is mad at me or I'm in trouble. And so that one is a hard one too, because sometimes we lean toward that, we're scared of God, or we're too casual with God. And then we're not honoring him as Lord. Like, what is it that you have to say? I talked about something the other day on social media, and I said, masking conflict is not the same as making peace.
That's true.
Y'all, I got more messages. The people going through with the conflict. People were like, I said what I feel, and I just hope the Lord work it out. I was like, wait a minute.
Or, yeah.
Or they're like, I don't fool with it because people don't know how to receive what I'm saying. Or, you know, like all of these different responses. But I put in there this idea of inviting Christ into it, because if we don't invite him into those everyday, mundane, relational things, then we've got him on the sideline like a friend, and we're not seeing him as Lord.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. See, my friend, Dawn is my friend. I'm not going to invite her into every conflict I have with people. I may get her advice on a few things, but for the most part, I'm going to deal with my conflict with her, whatever's between me and her. But if Dawn were a person of influence, like if she was my pastor or maybe someone I really, like this is the person that's guiding me spiritually, I would come to her for more, even the things that don't necessarily involve her. Mm-hmm. Y'all know what I'm saying?
Yes. Right.
Because when you respect someone, when you honor someone's authority, you say, wait, what do you think about this situation?
Right.
When you got somebody's time, you got somebody's ear that you respect, you throw in everything you can think of at them because you want their input.
Yes.
What happens when you only see God as friend, you end up treating him, you only talk to him about things you want him to do for you in your life and all these other things. You don't seek his opinion. You don't seek his values. You don't seek his standard. And then we wonder why stuff is going left.
Right.
And he says you can't have either or. So
right.
If I'm going to be friend, first of all, you can't even have that if you're not following my commandments.
Mm-hmm.
This friendship is a privilege of followership. This friendship comes with followership.
Yes.
You don't skip over following and then just get to be my friend. We're not homies.
Yeah,
that's right.
If you grew up in my generation, your parents would be like, I'm not one of your
little friends.
Right.
Not now right? One of your little friends.
Right. Not one.
Not
now,
one.
Conscious parenting, we all trying to be gentle parents, some of us. I'm still, now I will say, we can be friends, but I'm not your peer. See, well, because the reason why our parents used to say that is because they didn't want us to treat them casually like we treated people our same age, right? It wasn't that they didn't want to be our friend. It's just that when you were younger, you could not understand the difference. And if you got too casual with me as a parent, you're not going to follow my authority. Right. And that's why Jesus says, you can't even handle my friendship. Us walking and talking and breaking bread together and me coming into all these small, mundane, what seems like trivial moments where we're just there communing and connecting because you're not following me.
Yes.
And so that tension is something that we have to be very aware of, because the truth is we tend to lean one way or the other, and that can vacillate from day to day.
Yeah.
You're just looking at your life and you're like, let me just get my life right for right. God gonna get me.
Yeah. Let me just check the box.
You know, let me have my quiet time, let me open my app, let me go to church. And then you still miss out on like the whole relationship that you can have with God. And so that is definitely one that we have to work at. Okay, Don, give me one more. And then we're going to do some questions because we got some good questions, y'all.
Okay. I think the other one that really kind of challenged me was the confused but not hopeless.
That was during the experience endurance as the second one.
That's exactly it. Mm-hmm. And so this idea of, or perplexed but not in despair, if you're going to pull out the King James version, right?
The holy version.
Right. And I think Jada, the reason it challenged me, you and I have talked kind of offline, and so it's just this idea that, one, I can acknowledge that some stuff just don't make sense.
Mm-hmm.
Some stuff just confuses me.
Yeah.
Like, I don't really have explanation for it. For me, it's been a hard year, and there are some things that I'm going to let them in on a little bit. So part of this, it's been a hard year, and so we lost some family members. It's been like 5 and 7 months, so it's dumb.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't make sense. And so there have been moments of confusion.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, it's been sweet to embrace, but not hopeless.
Oof.
Yeah.
Right? Listen. Like, I know I don't understand.
Yeah.
No, it doesn't make sense. Yes, I'm hurting.
Yeah.
And I'm not hopeless.
Mm-hmm.
And so that tension for me and just the importance of being able to walk it out,
mm-hmm.
and say, no, I don't fully understand. And yes, right now I want to cry. And I still believe.
Yeah. And God is still good. Ooh, that's good.
That's good, Don.
He just is.
That's good.
Yeah. So that, what you said, I feel like there has been a lot of death. Just,
yes.
I don't know what's happening, because it's not just older people. It's just been a lot of death. And part of it is the world that we're living in. It's just, it is the nature of sin. You know, it take, not sin of the individual, sin in humanity. Like, we're not in this perfected kingdom that God has for us coming soon. But that heaviness, I think, is one of the things that has stretched my faith, because I'm like Job. I'm like, okay, if you take 3 things, but leave me 7, I mean, God, I get it. You know, sometimes we got to be stripped away for your glory, for our growth. You still faithful. You tell your friends, girl, listen, I don't even need it. God knows what's best. I trust in him. And he take the 4th thing, you're like, okay, I get it. I get it, God. But then he takes like that 8th thing.
Yes.
You're like, now hold on, God. Now wait a minute. And then you start trying to make sense of it.
Yep.
And you are left confused, because you're thinking, wait a minute, I'm actually living more for you this year than I was last year.
Yes.
I'm trying to be better in this area. I'm studying. I know you. I'm trying to apologize. I'm trying to be forgiven. I'm working on my healing and my pain, and I'm trying to honor you, and I'm serving. And what's happening is you are trying to apply a human formula,
yes,
mm-hmm.
to a divine outcome.
Yes.
To create a divine outcome. And it's not going to work. It will never add up. And that confusion is real.
Yeah.
And even when God doesn't take it away, it is the hope that gets us through.
Ooh.
It is saying that God did not bring clarity. God did not answer these questions, and I still have hope.
Oh, Lord.
Y'all, that's why the Bible calls us a peculiar people.
Yeah.
Because people look at you and say, why? Mm-hmm. Why do you still have hope?
Are you crazy?
And you're like, because I hope in God, not in what is happening in my life.
Yes.
And that is really the gospel, that we hope in the person of God, in the person of Jesus, not in the outcomes in our lives. And so that confusion thing, but still having hope, especially if you're a person where it needs to make sense, it make sense.
Yes.
I know y'all, some of y'all in here, y'all like, yes, it needs to make sense.
Yes. Yeah.
It needs to add up. And God is like, it won't.
Uh-uh.
It won't. But it don't make sense when I do things for you and you didn't earn it.
Right.
Right.
That didn't make sense either. You didn't want me to add that.
Right.
I'm just paying bills, knowing you wasn't tithing. That didn't add up. Right. All right. I'll take it.
Right.
Never mind, God. Do you. Just,
right.
You know. I'm good, because I don't really want to go through all of it.
Right.
I just, never mind. I just had a moment, you know. That's what Job said. You know what? You are God.
Right.
That's my bad. That's my bad. Because it's never going to make sense. But in the end, the goodness of God and the grace of God always outweighs whatever
right.
we feel like, you know, are those confusing moments. And so, yeah, that's really good. Any final thoughts? We're going to do a couple of questions and then get the people out.
What you just described was literally like... me and my husband's lives, like maybe like 9 years ago, almost 10. We were in Florida, and we're from Florida. We moved here after my mom convinced us to. It took her forever to, but we moved here, and she got sick.
Mm.
And we were newlyweds. We hadn't even been married a year yet. And we were young, and we had two small babies. We packed up, I think, like our clothes and this big old TV for his video game, and we drove down here in a Chevy Impala.
Come on.
And made it in 9 hours. Well, we were
Ooh.
Getting it from Florida. Yeah.
Thank God for no tickets.
Yes, thank him for them traveling mercies.
No, traveling mercies, that's the
uh-huh.
mercy.
And when we got here, this thing happened like overnight. Me and her were wrestling or play fighting or something on a Monday, and she was being transported to Baylor like that Friday, and they said, if you would have waited a week, you would be dead. And so the tension that I felt, when you just said, you're like, wait, this don't add up. I'm like,
right.
at some point during that process, I have a new job. I was in training at a new job. You know you can't miss work when you start
right.
a new job.
Right.
I'm looking at them like my mom's sick. They looking like, are you coming or not? I
yeah.
mean, it was just bad. But I mean, I look at the tension that I felt. I would have never signed up for that. I wouldn't have wished cancer on my worst enemy. And I was like, something is just, I don't know what I'm holding on to.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how to describe it. You get called crazy.
Yeah.
They looking at you like, you should be in a psych ward. And I'm like, I know.
Right.
I really should.
Right.
I mean, am I there?
Yeah.
But I mean, you, when your world starts crashing down around you.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, all my friends, they were begging God for a husband, and I had one. And at that time, I was like, look, I just need some space, okay?
Right.
And we newlyweds,
where is the receipt?
Please, can I return this real quick? it just...
Wait, how long had y'all been married?
We hadn't even been married a year yet.
Oh, yeah. It was fresh, but then it was...
It was fresh, but it wasn't like buyer's remorse fresh within them first 30 days. So,
yeah
it wasn't like, that fresh.
What did we do?
Right,
yeah.
right. I'm like, maybe something, but you know, it all worked out.
Yeah.
And when you describe the taking one thing, then another, I'm
mm-hmm.
like, okay, I can take this, but I'm going to see her now and she can't walk.
Yeah.
She can't talk. She's a different color.
Mm-hmm.
She's not anything. Like
yeah.
she's wasting away. I remember mm-hmm. her hospital room saying to her and God, why did you bring me here to die? How dare you bring me and my family here just to die?
Mm-hmm.
And God, you letting this happen.
Mm-hmm.
And I just left. That was probably one of the lowest moments in my life. And I went home, and my husband was like, hey, and I was like,
I don't want to.
Went in the room. I was out.
Was he trying to be spiritual? Was he trying to be spiritual?
Oh, no.
No.
Oh.
No. Oh, never mind.
No, wasn't no spiritual conversations happening.
Okay.
But, you know, when you talked about him bringing us out, that
mm-hmm.
that was one of the things. And when Dawn said confusion, I thought about when you said that the enemy will stir up confusion where
Ooh.
God has already provided clarity. I knew better. I knew the next steps. I came up in that, and I was like, you know what? once I identified this ain't nothing but the enemy, things started changing. But when you broke it down, how you just explained it, that was my testimony like so many years ago.
That's a word, girl. And y'all, and see, that's the thing. When so much is happening, it seems like this is a blessing. I'm newly married. We're moving, relocating. You have this sense of newness. And okay, clearly God is in this. And then what you're walking into is the thing you least expected. You're like, God, are you sure you moved me here for this? You uprooted my life so that I could come be in this kind of pain. I think that is the moment where our faith is making some decisions. Are we gonna stay in the less mature place of saying, I'm gonna disconnect from God because he's failing me? Or are we gonna press through and actually see God himself bigger than the hospital room and the diagnosis, but just to see God himself, because that's where the clarity is. The enemy is not in the sickness. Right. The enemy wasn't in the cancer. The enemy was in the fact that he made you question who God was because of the sickness. That's the enemy, right? So the enemy didn't give Eve rotten fruit. The fruit was still good. He made her question, would God withhold a good thing from her? And so it is when we have those moments, we have to recognize that the enemy is not just in the business of making your life hard. Because even if that happens, he has to have permission from God. The enemy's one of his main goals is to make you question who God is. And if a hard life is all it takes for you to question God, then the enemy is winning.
That's right.
The enemy is winning. And that's where we see that clarity. Where God, if you've ever had that moment where it's like a spiritual fog is lifted and you start to see things and you're like, oh, I see this for what it is. Mm-hmm. You know what? Y'all tried to get me, but I see this for what it is. I'm experiencing some hard things. I didn't expect to be divorced. I didn't expect to experience this death. I didn't expect to be unemployed. I didn't expect to be moving back home with my parents or whatever is going on in your life. But you're like, that's a decoy. There's something behind this, and the enemy wants me to focus on this very surface thing so I don't really see that God has good things for me, even in the midst of very difficult situations. Do y'all know what kind of spiritual confusion has to be cast for a person to be surrounded by provision and abundance and only focus on the one thing they could not have? Yeah. Now, we don't stand in judgment of Adam and Eve because we do it all the time.
Right.
I'm so desperate to be married, I cannot appreciate that I'm blessed with good friendships.
Yes.
I'm so desperate to have this home or to have this next level of status that I really can't appreciate that God has continued to provide for me. Like, we start missing you could not count and measure the abundance in the garden.
Yes.
All you could do, all she could do, all Adam could do was focus on the one thing they couldn't have. And the enemy's like, I didn't even have to do nothing. Mm-hmm. I just had to distract you. I just had to stir up some questions for you. And so that's why, you know, finding that clarity in God and God alone, regardless of what's happening, is so life-changing. Because then life is going to keep happening. And you're like, but I already know what this is, y'all. That is the goal. Y'all know what I'm saying? That spiritual maturity is to be able to see through surface earthly things and say, what is the spiritual activity behind this? What is really happening? It is like when your kids come in, my kid comes in and my youngest one, y'all, I've talked about her before because she's spicy. And I am learning that her spice, because she's young, it is one of her go-to responses. She just gets kind of snappy, you know? And again, you know, I'm trying to be evolved. And so sometimes I just look at her and I say, you know what Nana and Papa would have done to me if I just did what you did? Nana and Papa, yes, I'm telling on them. They not who you think they are. I'm telling. But now I'm starting to see things, and I really had to pray about it, because you know, if you only have one tool in the tool belt, that's just not going to serve anybody well, especially in friendship or parenting, whatever the case may be. And as I have prayed about it over the years, the Lord has really shown me just how she's wired, her temperament, her personality. She's very contrarian. She don't have an agreeable spirit. She just is the kind of person that says, you know what, it's hot today. And the other person says, I mean, it's warm, but it's not hot. You know people like that. You are probably one of those people.
Those are good people. Those are good people.
This is Don. Don is contrarian. Yeah. So if I'm just like, you know, it's kind of cold in here. She's like, I mean, it's cooler than normal, but it's not cold.
Right.
Like, those people don't even realize they naturally disagree. It's not bad because you need those people. They're going to give you good ideas and sharpen you, blah, blah, blah. But while she's six, I need a spirit of agreement to come over her. So sometimes I really am praying about it, and I'm going to tell you one of the things the Lord showed me about her even when she was 4 years old. He was saying, this is how she's wired. It's one of her default emotions. Some kids default to crying. Some kids default to running away. Some kids default to whatever. Hers is this kind of resilience, like I'm going to resist everything you're saying. Like she just wants to say no. And when the Lord started showing me that this is like her one of her main tools, she's only a kid, so she only got two or three tools. As you mature, you get more tools. I started seeing through what it was. Mm-hmm. And I was like, you know what? This is not about me. She's not trying to calculate how to make me upset. This is how she knows to protect herself. She doesn't want to be controlled. She don't want to be told, you know, this whole thing. So I remember one day, I was like, I was about to come downstairs, and I was like, Chloe, it's time for a bath. And I am one of those, I don't give you a lot of warnings, so that's me, I'm abrupt. I'm like, shut that down, lights off, TV off, everybody's bath time. And which, you know, hey. But I remember I was coming down the stairs, and the Lord, I know it was the Lord, because I know my flesh didn't say it. He said, just tell her, in 5 minutes, everything off upstairs. And I said, why? I want it off now. It's like, just do it. So I go down, y'all, and I'm like, hey, 5 minutes, then everything off upstairs. This girl said, yes, ma'am. I was like, oh, Jesus. Honey, I was looking for a white cloud, white horse, the son of man coming back. I was like, that is usually a, how you gonna answer? Did you answer me right? Like, it's all, she just said, and the Lord was like, see? You are fighting something that wasn't even the issue. She's a human being, and yes, you have the authority, but you can also love her well. Just give her a little warning. Gonna change the whole situation. Y'all, that would have been a whole 30 minutes of me trying to hold myself together. And it was just an insight. And I say all that to say, as he's shown me how to parent, it's changed my relationships too. So sometimes a friend will send a text that seems hurtful, or they'll say something that seems unkind, or they didn't respond to something that you thought they should have responded to. And God is like, don't deal with what you see. You've got to learn how to deal with the unseen. If you're going to be a spiritual being, if you are made in my image, if you are a holder of my Holy Spirit, you cannot fight every battle that's in the physical. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. That is not just about attack. That is about seeing beyond. When someone says something that might seem hurtful, it's not about you. Could it be that you caught them at a moment where they could not handle whatever it is you said, and God is saying, I need you to love them through it. They don't need to explain it to you. They don't owe you an apology. You don't have to withhold your love. You don't have to uninvite them. You don't have to give them a look. You don't have to walk by and not speak. You're looking at the wrong thing.
Amen.
See behind that. There's pain there. There's some brokenness there. There's some place where only with a spiritual perspective,
yes,
can you look beyond the surface, beyond the physical, and then do what God has asked you to do in that moment.
Yes.
If not, you're going to be so worried about protecting your pride and protecting yourself and making sure you never taken advantage of and make sure people treat you a certain way, and how could you lie to me like you God and you never lie, and how could you do this and how could you do that, as opposed to God saying you are missing spiritual assignment because you're distracted by the surface activity.
That's right.
You're missing it. And so that whole clarity, it shows up not just in things that happen in our lives, but as we love well,
mm-hmm,
love our friends well, love God well, live in a way that's pleasing to him. And so that tension, y'all, to be able to see what's happening on the surface, but respond to what's happening in the spirit,
that
will shift. It really will. It will shift the way you interact with God and the way you live as a believer.
So I hope you enjoyed today's episode. If you did, make sure leave a comment, leave a review, share, subscribe, all the things, and we'll catch you next time.